Hi, welcome to Wrokdown. I'm Wendy Stapleton. Some musos have their day in the sun and then quietly recede back into day-to-day life afterwards. A handful are able to repeat their success by branching out into different forms of media. Well, whether or not it's being in the right place at the right time, one thing's for sure, you need the goods. And our next guest has all of that. Please welcome the clown prince of music, radio and TV, Wilbur Wilde.
I'm psychologically addicted to adrenaline.
Willie, I didn't write that intro and I would never call you a clown prince. You know what I'd call you?
What's that called?
The clown king.
The clown king, thank you. No, I think just listening to you there, yeah. You know, that thing about receding back into day-to-day life, mm-hmm. I consider this to be my day-to-day life, as mm-hmm. you do.
Yeah.
You know? And when somebody says to you after you've been in a band, well, hang on, let me just back up a little. I played in the orchestra at school, sang in the choir, marched in the cadet band, loved the music, liked the involvement. So in my final year of school, instead of continuing on with the sciences and whatever, a doctor or maybe a science person, like a researcher or something like that.
I'm glad you didn't become a doctor, Willie.
A scientist guy. Yeah. I think I'd have very good bedside manner. I think I don't think politeness hurts. But I just had a passion for it. You know, and then you know, you see your first rock and roll band, which happened to be at a school concert when I was like in first form, and the sixth formers, the year 12 guys, had put a rock band together. And I mean, you know, it was just fantastic. Like, you know, we'd sung in the choir and done a couple of hymns. The orchestra had played a couple of dirgy classical bits, although we did play some modern pieces as well. And then a rock band came on, and they had like, you know, four coloured lights on either side of the stage, and they had amplifiers, and their hair, I think it was like an agreement they'd reached with the headmaster prior to the concert, their hair was below collar length.
Did you study formally?
Yeah. You know, I studied music in my final year after I had not studied it for a few years there, and that was a cause of consternation to the faculty, if you will, because the headmaster said, well, look, hang on, you know, you haven't been studying music, and the music teacher said, you haven't been studying music. I said, oh, I'll be all right, okay. And I actually have, from school, a letter from my headmaster once I'd passed my HSC.
Because you went to Ivanhoe Grammar?
But I've got a letter from him congratulating me. He said, you know, congratulations on the achievement of your HSC. I was wrong, you were right. And it was just a very gracious thing. I then studied at I went to Monash for about 6 months, and that wasn't what I wanted to do. It was a music sort of mathematical analysis sort of type of thing, whereas I wanted to play and compose. And then I ended up, a couple of years after that, I went to the Sydney Conservatorium to do the jazz course. But by then, you know, I was playing in bands, and I ran away and joined Old 55 after about 6 months.
Did you run away?
Well, ran away from school, you know what I mean. I was living up there. I'd been a year on the Gold Coast playing in a nightclub 6 nights a week, so you sort of get your chops together like that, and such as they are. And when the opportunity to join Old 55 came up, I thought, great, you know, this is... And the point I was trying to make is I didn't get into it, I don't think any of us did, to, like, be famous, or to have gold records, or to host Countdown, or whatever. You know, your motivation was, mine, was to hang out, have some fun, you know, drink some booze, and play. And you know, play in front of people, and get them dancing, and, you know, hang out with some chicks, and have some laughs.
So was that Sydney?
That was in Sydney, between 1975 and 1977. And that's where I met Frank Holden,
Frank Holden,
you know, with whom you and I work regularly.
Still.
And have done for...
Last week
and for 20 years, you know, probably longer, when you and Frank were at the Roxy and then I was sort of hanging out, you know, around about the same time. And, I mean, those long-term associations, well, it's what I'm doing here today, to come and have a chat with a friend. And Frank and I, after 33 years...
We
still talk to each other. He describes it as a marriage. He's, you know, in front of the audience, he'll say, oh, now, you know, Wilbur and I have been working together for 33 years. Anybody been married that long? He said, yeah, me too. The only thing we ever argue about is the sex and the money. You know, so never really argue about sex.
Old 55? How long?
A couple of years.
And then did you join Jo Zep straight after that?
I left Old 55 on a Sunday in early May in Sydney, in Canberra, returned to Sydney, and I was sharing a house with my friend Eric McCusker, who of course went on to write Come Said the Boy and State of the Heart, amongst other things, Chemistry for Mondo Rock. He said, well, I'm on the road with John English, and we're doing the Brian Ferry tour. I'll see if he needs a horn player. So on the Sunday afternoon, we called John, and on the Monday night, I was on stage at the Horton Pavilion with the John English Band. So, you know,
On the Brian Ferry tour,
and we played about four shows at the Horton Pavilion over the next couple of nights, then went to Melbourne, played Festival Hall. One show, the last show we did with on that tour was at a midnight show at on Sunday night, and it was at Festival Hall where they just had World Championship Wrestling, right? So the wrestlers went first, then... You know, the wrestling audience went home and they let the rock and roll, you know, Brian Ferry and the John English audience in. And I remember Brian Ferry having to, on his way to the dressing rooms, follow it like a trail of blood that had been left by the... An old, nutty old art school Brian Ferry is going, oh, thoroughly delightful. Yes, it was wonderful. You know, so we did that gig. Got, you know, so that took us through till early Monday morning. And on the Monday, I kid you not, on the Monday, I got a phone call from the then manager of Jo Zep and the Falcons.
Who was that?
Steve Hill, who was also at one stage preceding Shirley Strawn, the lead singer with Skyhooks.
Oh, really?
Yeah, Steve Hill was. He's written on ahead now, unfortunately. But he called me up and he said, oh, Joe wants you at rehearsal tomorrow at Gary Young's place at 1 o'clock in the afternoon. I said, beauty. So I went from
there to there to there. To
yeah, it was like being out of work for a total of about 12 hours.
Okay, we're going to take a short break, but when we come back, I want to go back a little bit and find out how you and Frank ended up with your names.
Tell you all about it.
Okay, we'll be back soon.
Wrokdown.
My special guest tonight is my buddy.
Yes.
My good buddy, Willie, Wilbur Wilde. Will,
you know, we do love you. We love you.
You know, do you?
That? Yeah, we do, in a spiritual and deep way, because you are who you are. But anyway, I don't want to gush. What's the next question you've got for me, darling?
Is that gush or blush? You're making me blush.
Well, I don't want to gush and I don't want to make you blush, because you know that. That's okay. Right.
How did you get the name? Because I know you were born in Melbourne.
Nikki
Aitken?
Nikki Aitken, yeah.
Aitken?
Yeah. I'm still little Nikki. My mum still calls me Nick.
Okay, so Nikki, little Nikki. Grew into Big Nikki.
Well, in 1975, back at the Sydney Conservatorium, I was Nikki Aitken. Then, driving around with the aforementioned Eric McCusker in his father Brian's Gemini, we were listening to what was then 2JJ. It's now 2JJJ, of course. It was 2JJ back then. And an announcement came over asking for auditioners, saxophone players, who want to join rock and roll band, 50s revival band, Old 55. Auditioners to go to West Ride Youth Club, it was, right? I was the only guy that showed up. They'd been together for a month or so, right?
Mm-hmm.
I joined probably in the late July of 75. I went for that audition. And being the only guy that showed up, I got the gig, right? And they didn't know anything about it, you know? I mean, if some guy had come in with a tin whistle, they would go, oh, yeah, that sounds great. Frankie J. Holden, or Peter, as we know him also, or as his wife knows him, was a chartered accountant with Price Waterhouse, right? So he arrived carrying a briefcase, wearing a suit. The first gig, in fact, I went to one rehearsal only with Old 55. That was like a couple of days later, and then we had a gig on Double J. We played live for about an hour. At the end of the gig, because they'd been together for a month, they already had their names. Frank was introducing the band, saying, on drums, Drainpipe, Rockpile Jones, Meatballs McPatrick, Jimmy Boy Manzi, I'm Frankie J. Holden. He's turned around to me. I could have said Nikki Aitken, but I thought a guy that I'd been playing with on the Gold Coast the year before, Roger Felice Andrew, used to play with Thunderclap Newman. We were in a band with Ray Brown. Ray Brown and the Whispers we're playing with on the coast, you know. And he used to tell me stories about two imaginary friends of his, Vivian Varvoom, an internationally famous fashion model, and her millionaire playboy consort, Wilbur Wilde. So I thought, I'll just borrow Wilbur Wilde for the time, until I can think of something else. You know, I wanted to call myself Albert Hall. So at least we could have recorded an album live at Albert Hall's place. Anyway, but it just stuck. It just stuck, Wilbur Wilde. Isn't that funny?
No, it's a fabulous name.
Well, it just you know, it was like one of those things that, you know, and Baker, Glenn A. Baker, he said, no, that's perfect. We need this wild man. And he described me, this gangly, huge, praying mantis type. Oh, yes. Because he had a vision. For, like, he'd cast the band. You know what I mean? He had a, there was a thing. It wasn't just a bunch of guys getting together. He actually had a role. if you will, for each member to play. And I mean, certainly we contributed.
It was very successful.
It was very successful. Hey, in 1976, we knocked, with our album Take It Greasy, ABBA off the number one spot nationally. So you owe us for that.
Absolutely. So, okay.
Let's, and then it just stuck.
And then that's it stuck. 30, so you Wilbur
33 Wilde. Years down the track, Wilbur Wilde became a professional and you know, legitimate name. It's my other real name, as I refer to it.
Well, the thing is that I would imagine that not many people know you as, or didn't even know that you weren't Wilbur Wilde.
Well, mind that's you, fair enough, yeah.
You'd have a pretty cruel mother to call you Wilbur if your name
was
Wilde.
Yeah, I know. Yeah, anyway, she did have a sense of humour, though.
I know, she's a funny lady. Jo Zep.
Yep.
Another really successful band, and of course, even to this day, as we all know, Joe, we all still do gigs with Joe.
Isn't it just so precious, though, that we are doing those gigs? And I know that you've had guests on the show who have, like Joe and Caddy and Shorick and Russell Morris and, you know, Renee, to people who have shaped the, you know, and I mean, there's another dozen, mm-hmm. another 30 or 40 that... names that I could mention. But people, the point being that people who have shaped the culture of the country and continue to do so.
Continue to do so.
By working at the coalface, you know. I'm James Rain and
absolutely.
Mark Seymour and, you know, great artists. Now, I know, you know, yeah. I'm leaving a lot out there, but the point being that they're very precious. And those long-term associations, Joe Camilleri and I, when I joined the Falcons, I was there for about 4.5 years. We were inseparable. I mean, I just, you know, he was a great frontman and a great friend. And to this day is too. Mm-hmm. Frank, I've been blessed to work with two of the greatest frontmen in this country. You know, Frank Holden is just sensational. And of course, his talents haven't just stopped at you know, rock and roll. I mean, acting and theatre.
I know, and actually, you know. I'll have to get Frank down here to...
Of course.
You know, it's Underbelly and all those things. But talking about yourself...
Oh, back to me, please.
See, the other thing is, apart from your rock?
Yeah.
Your jazz,
yeah,
you know, you've been playing in wonderful venues.
Well, I love that. I love the jazz thing. Here's, I'll give you an example, right? When I first started on Hey Hey It's Saturday, 1984, we'd get invites to the Logies, right, every year. Now, and it was sort of, it's it kind of says something about me. I'm not sure what it says about me, but... You get an invite to the Logie, and they're just like, oh, you're going to the Logies and things like that. So, well, it's great. And I mean, you're excited. Now, and the show used to win them and everything. And Daryl would be up the front, and he's, you know, your name would get called in. It's fantastic. And the tables of 10, there's lots of booze, and, you know, people say, yeah, yo, and showbiz, and Don Lane walks by. I knocked back about 3 invitations. I had to say, oh, look, I'll see you at the after party. I said, well, why? I said, oh, I'm playing a jazz gig at the Limerick. You know.
I know you've always loved it that much.
But that's the priority. You know, I mean, with respect to the television thing, which has been fantastic for me, you know, and brought about another whole thing, you know, with theatre and, you know, well, you know, you're in the public eye. So, but it was just that important to me where I didn't even think about, and I wouldn't change it now, incidentally, but I just took it for granted that people would understand that I'm playing a $110 jazz gig in front of 80 people on that night. And I said, well, can't go to the Logies. I said, but it's the Logies. I said, it's a jazz gig.
But I know, that's the wonderful thing. I know you love it that much.
It's not blinkered. It's just where those priorities lay. And I wouldn't change it.
As you said, you know, you knocked back invitations to the Logies and things like that to go and play your jazz gigs. But the fact that you... We're on Hey Hey for how long?
16 years.
16 years.
I never knocked back a Hey Hey to do a jazz gig. That's a different thing. Because
you were playing anyway.
Because you were playing anyway.
You were playing.
And that was another thing. It was a fantastic thing. Hmm. You know.
But you were playing on that, and of course...
From 84, when we first went nighttime, and that was when Kerry Packer had given the then executive producer, Gavin Disney, a sort of, not an ultimatum, well, an ultimatum, I suppose, or parameter. He said, you got 8 weeks. If it doesn't work then.
Is this going night?
Going night, because it was successful in the morning.
Of course it was, yeah.
You know, and then it started to sort of bubble along. We used to do that show with no audience for a lot of the years. Obviously, there was no audience. They might have a theme audience maybe twice a year. The rest of the time was in Studio Night. And it was all dark, all the audience seats where you see the footy show now. You know, there's a couple of hundred people sitting there for the footy show. That was just dark.
When Red came on board.
1986.
Was that strictly as a guitarist to start with?
No.
Or was it... Because a lot of people actually thought that you two had come together as this, like, comedy routine.
Well, they'd asked... In negotiations, it had been suggested that because of cutbacks at the network that we take a pay cut, or I take a pay cut. I mean, I wasn't getting paid a lot. So I said, no, you know, that's lousy. And I mean, I stood my ground. And, of course, they just started doing the show without me. And the first week the show went to air, I said, oh, this is not very good. I haven't negotiated this very well at all.
Mm-hmm.
Right. And I called Gavin. I said, I called Ernie Carroll, who's Aussie. And I said, Ernie, I haven't handled this very well, have I? He said, well, look, you know, we'll see what happens. So Gavin Disney, the following Saturday morning, called me. And he said, g'day, it's Gavin. I said, yeah, how are you? He said, what are you doing? I said, not much. He said, what are you doing today? Later on, maybe, about 6:30. I said, I don't know. Might come along. He said, you want to do a TV show? I said, yeah. Okay, you know, it was like one of those. So we came back, but they'd got Red to replace me.
Oh, is that what happened?
That's what happened. You know, they said, oh, well, you know. And then...
So they were tough.
Oh, look, I think, you know, who knows? They knew I liked it. They knew, you know. And I mean, it certainly didn't hurt bringing Red into the fold, because he'd been like a regular guest, and I mean, he knows how to handle himself. And as it turned out, for the next, 16 years, or, you know, the next 14 years, both of us sort of became... we were already friends, but we became sort of like, you know, collaborators.
Like the two, I know.
Yeah, the guys, those guys who sat over there and sort of interrupted.
Wrokdown.
My special guest this evening is the wonderful Willie Wilde, movie star.
I'm good at some things. I think I'm wonderful sometimes.
Willie, I didn't know that you were in Mad Max.
Well, I put it on my CV.
Yes.
All right.
What were you doing?
Because my then girlfriend's friend was a guy named John Lee. Actually, Michelle's friend, my girlfriend, her friend was Ella Lee, who was married to John Lee, who's the guy in Mad Max who gets a saucepan through his neck, right?
Right.
Okay, this is in the sort of, you know, in the caravan. So, okay, right. So John Lee, he's a good actor. Don't know what he's up to these days. But
he's got a big thing in his neck.
Yeah. I don't know whether that saucepan sticking out of his neck affects his chances of getting work, but, you know, I wish him well. You know, perhaps, I don't know, he could read for...
you know, the Tin Man.
Oh, what a beautiful... No, he couldn't read for Oklahoma with that. But still, his idea for me and Michelle, because they needed a couple of extras, right?
Yeah.
This is Dr. George Miller. And, you know, Mel Gibson's in Mad Max, right?
I know.
So, right. So we're hanging out. About, must have been 78. We're all living in South Yarra. And he said, oh, we need a couple of extras, you know, $40 a day. And I said, yeah, cool. You know, why not? So Michelle and I go out there. Now, in the opening scenes of Mad Max, another great Australian actor, Hugh Keyes Byrne, is looking. He's leaning on the roof of a cop car, looking through the crosshairs of a rifle scope at two young lovers in the field, right? He's sort of having a bit of a snigger, like this. The girl's on top and everything like that. And then he sounds the siren, and these two young lovers scurry off like scared rabbits. One of those blancmange-like bottoms disappearing into the distance belongs to moi. And
well,
the other one to Michelle
go.
Johnson.
Yeah. There you go. I'm going to go home tonight. So, I'm going to go and hire it.
That's all I'm in Mad Max for.
Mad Max, the first Mad Max.
Yeah, the seminal Australian movie, Mad Max. But I'm still putting it on my CV. It's like I tell people that I'm, on my CV it has that I'm an award-winning actor, right? Now, I'm an actor. And I won an award once for being the most popular brass and reed player in 1977 as voted by the readers of Ram magazine. Now, it's an award.
Yes.
I'm an actor.
And you're an
award-winning actor. But still. No, I went on to have dialogue in some films, you know. And I just love the involvement. Yeah,
you have an album coming out. You have a book coming out.
I've got a film.
That's a whole...
I've got a film
and another TV show.
Another TV show.
Am I in it?
You're in it, yeah.
I love you.
Yeah.
He's my mate.
Thank you, Willie.
Thank you, Don. At this stage of Wrokdown, we feel we can introduce you to some new music from up-and-coming singers and bands. Nawara Madison is a young country singer who writes her own material and has her own website, which you can find through our website, which is www.wrokdown.com, just .com. Now, she's recorded an independent CD. This song's called Lonely Alone. It's the start of what we think will be a big future. She's absolutely gorgeous, isn't she, Willie?
Oh, yes.
So thanks, Wilbur.
Pleasure, Dars.
And we're going to leave you with Narara. See you next week.
I could stop right here, turn this car around, walk back through the door, put my suitcase down, tell you I'm sorry, and things would be alright, I know. But it all comes down to the lesser of two. Alone by myself or alone with you. If I have to be lonely, I'd rather be lonely alone. I'd rather miss someone out on this highway than someone who's sitting just 3 feet away. I'd rather be fighting some old memory than to wonder if you ever really loved me. I could keep going on like I have all.
I don't know where I'll go. There's a lot I'm not sure of, but one thing I know, if I have to be lonely, I'd rather